It's been a few years since I've been here, but since the last time I was here, I got fat. And fuck you. Here's what happened. I was like my regular kind of fat. You know what I mean? Like that kind of fat where you look at me and you go, you know, Russell, if you would just run, like once. That's the problem with being Indian, we get fat. We're born skinny, that's the real problem. We're born skinny, we're naturally a skinny race of people. And we're born skinny and we stay skinny. We don't have to work hard to be skinny. We could be skinny and eat whatever we want and stay skinny. And then we never go to the gym because we're skinny, we don't need to. And our parents don't encourage you to go to the gym. You're like, Dad, I'm gonna go to the gym. What's in the gym? They have studies in the gym? No, you're not going to the gym, you stay home and do your studies. And because you never tone up, you stay this like really smushy kind of skinny, you know? And you eat whatever you want your entire life, and then at 30, your Indian genes kick in and go, okay, party's over. And then you just get fat, and it's like a fucking awful fat that we get. And that's what happened to me. I mean, I'm much older than that now, but I got like a weird kind of fat. I was like my normal fat, and then I woke up one morning, I was like, poof. I was like, oof, I'm bloated. I figured I would pee it out, I would sweat it out, I'd be fine the next day. Anyway, cut to a year and a half later, and I'm still, and I go, something's wrong. So I go to the doctor, I go, Doc, I got fat. He goes, yes. I said, thanks, asshole, I didn't come here for confirmation. I came here to find out why I got fat. He goes, well, why do you think you're fat? I said, because I have a mirror. And I walked past it naked the other day and I thought somebody else was in my room. Oh my God, whose fat hairy ass is that? Turns out it was my stomach. It was. And people on the internet were calling me fat. You guys are dicks, by the way. You say whatever you want to us on the internet, and if we respond, we're assholes. So we just have to take the abuse. But sometimes I get mad when people say things to me on the internet, not because of what they said, more so because it's probably something I would have said. And then I'm mad that my own words are getting used against me. Like, I posted something for this TV show I was on, and somebody goes, holy shit, did you eat your whole cast? And I was like, damn it, I would have said that too. I probably would have said that too. And then somebody posted a picture with me, and somebody commented and went, Russell Peters looking thicker than a Snicker. I got mad at that because I love a good rhyme, thicker than a Snicker. That's a good one too. It's not a fair way to describe a human. I think thicker than a Snicker is a great way for me to describe my penis. I think that's a wonderful way to describe it. So Russell, tell me about your penis. Well, it's thicker than a Snicker. Equally dark and veiny texture. Packed with nuts. And it satisfies. So I said to my doc, I said, Doc, it doesn't make sense that I should be getting as fat as I'm getting. He said, why not? I said, because I don't eat crazy, and I train jiu-jitsu every other day. He's like, huh. How old are you now? I said, 48. He goes, and you're Indian? I go, yeah, but... He goes, you haven't had a heart attack yet? I said, no, I haven't had a heart attack yet. He goes, all right. So he takes blood, and I leave. Calls me back in 3 days later. I go back in. He's like, hey, I got your blood back. I know what's wrong. I go, what's wrong? He goes, it's your thyroid. I go, what about it? He goes, you have an underactive thyroid. I go, so what does that mean? It means it's not doing enough. I said, I understand what the fuck underactive means. He goes, then why did you ask? I said, how is it affecting me? He goes, the thyroid's making you fat. I go, the thyroid's making me fat. He goes, no, you're doing things too, but the thyroid's really helping. I go, so what do we gotta do? He said, we gotta speed your thyroid up. I was like, let's get that bitch moving, right? So it's been a year and a half now, and I lost 24 pounds from it, but it wasn't me, it was the medication, it's not me. And I've lost, like, my body's in much better shape than it's ever been, but my fucking head is fat as shit, and I don't know how to, I look like a fucking thumb. Do you know how hard it is to lose a fat head? It's almost impossible. I used to box. There's tricks when you want to lose weight and from your body. In boxing, you could put on a garbage bag and you go sit in the sauna and you sweat it off. Let me give you some friendly advice. You can't do that with your head. I know. I found out the hard way. I was like, you know what? I got this. I grabbed a plastic bag. I threw it over my big, stupid head. I'm not an idiot. I cut a hole for my nose. It was a substantial hole. And I went and sat in the sauna. But I forgot, when you have a larger nose and you inhale, you tend to suck up more than the average human. And I took a deep breath in the sauna and sucked up the plastic bag. And my friends thought I was trying to commit suicide in the dumbest way possible. But when I got fat, I got like a weird kind. Indian people, we get the worst kind of fat. Like it just goes everywhere. Like white people, you ever see white Americans? When they get fat, it's just bam, a belly. And you can't tell from behind. You're like, hey, look at that white guy. He turns around like, hello. And like. But Indians, it just shows up in the weirdest places. I started to grow tits. But not in front, on the side. I don't know where the fuck they were going, but I was growing side tits. And they were like armrests. I was walking around after a while. It was like I was going to go into a pool with some floaties on the whole time. And then I was getting a fat back. That was a weird thing to get. It was like fat on my back. I would sit down and my fat back would hang over the chair. I'm like, what the f-? I would grab it and go, this feels nice, but not on me. I don't like this. And then I had a chunk of fat, like a big, like right here, a big, huge clump of fat. Like when a woman gets fat here, it's called a gunt, because it's a gut right above her. You know what I mean? So it's so it's a gunt. And I guess when I had it, it's a gawk. I guess it'd be a gawk. I guess, I don't know. Literally for a year and a half, I didn't see my penis. I would have to lift it up to visit. You still there, buddy? Okay, good. And I'd rest. Don't worry, the sun will shine one day. And. You know, but people come up to me after shows all the time, like, hey, Russell, you, what? You do blow? What? Coke, you do cocaine? I go, do I fucking look like I do cocaine? If I'm doing cocaine and my face is still this fat, I'm doing cocaine wrong. Hey, give me another line, yeah. Ho-ho! No, I don't do cocaine. Have you seen the size of my nose? You can't afford to do cocaine with a nose this big. You go broke after one try. Wouldn't be able to do lines, I'd have to do lanes. It's not a reasonable drug of choice. Then why are you always sniffing? I'll tell you exactly, I'm aware that I sniff a lot, and I'll tell you exactly why I sniff. I used to box. And when I was boxing, I broke my nose. But I didn't know I broke my nose, so it never got fixed. And of course I would have broken my nose. It's been literally 30 years since I've broken my nose, but I didn't know because I thought a broken nose looked like a broken nose. I thought it was like the guys in my gym where there was nothing, and then a nub, and they're like, what's up, champ? I didn't know. I just thought I was a bleeder when I would get punched in the face. Last year is when I found out. I went to the doctor last year because I was having trouble breathing. I go, hey, doc, I'm having trouble breathing. He goes, what's the problem? I go, one nostril works, and then the other one doesn't. And then when the other one stops working, the other one starts working. It's like there's a flap in there, like a train, you know, local, express. He goes, you ever broke your nose? I said, no. He said, you sure? I said, doc, I'm not an idiot. Pretty sure I'd know if I broke my nose. He said, didn't you tell me you used to box? I said, yeah. He goes, so wait, you used to box and you never broke that? I said, doc, I never broke my nose. He goes, wait, hold on a second. You're trying to tell me you were so good at boxing that you managed to avoid breaking the biggest fucking thing on your body. So I'm telling you, I never broke my nose. He goes, if you never broke that fucking nose in boxing, you should have 10 world titles by now. I said, I never broke it. He goes, lean forward, you fucking idiot. So I leaned forward. He goes like this. Yeah, your nose is broken. I go, how do you know that? He goes, because I'm a doctor. Yeah, but how can you tell? He goes, because it's not connected. I go, if it's not connected, why didn't it fall off? He goes, you're a fucking idiot. He goes, look, nobody's nose should move around like this. I shouldn't be able to move it around and double click and order shit off Amazon from your face. This is not a normal nose. I go, that's a broken nose? He goes, yeah, what did you think it was? Okay, don't judge me, all right? This is actually what I thought this was. And understand, I've been a comedian for 30 years and I have a creative mind. Here's really what I thought this was. You know how humans, this is how you know it's gonna be dumb. You know how humans are an ever-evolving species? Like if you looked at humans from 10,000 years ago, you go, what the fuck were those? Well, in 10,000 years, those humans are gonna look at us and go, what the fuck were those? Well, so because of evolution and my own ego, I thought that I was evolving at a faster rate than you. And that my body, to accommodate the larger nose, had developed some sort of joint hinge system in here to alleviate the weight. I don't know, I'm not a doctor. He goes, you're fucking retarded. I said, doc, you actually cannot say that anymore. What, that you're fucking retarded? Yeah, you can't say retarded anymore, doctor. No, I could say it. No, you can't, because it's offensive to people. I'm not talking about anybody else. I'm talking about you. You're a fucking retard. And I go, no, doc, you can't say retard or retarded at all anymore. He goes, I'm not talking about anybody. I'm talking about you. And as a matter of fact, I'm putting it in your notes. I said, you're putting in my notes that I'm a retard? He goes, no, I'm putting that you're a fucking retard. He goes, lean forward. I lean forward. He goes, let me show you something. I lean forward. He goes like this. Okay, now breathe. And I go, oh, that's amazing. What'd you do? He goes, I attached your nose. This is awesome. He goes, I could fix it and you could breathe like that for the rest of your life. I said, yes, please, let's do that. He goes, you gotta make an appointment and then you need 3 weeks where you can't fly. Well, I don't have 3 weeks where I can't fly, so I haven't had it fixed yet. But now I'm scared to get it fixed in case I end up looking like a pig and then all my Muslim friends don't come and see me anymore because they're like, he looks like a haram pig, we cannot go see him any longer. You know, Indian parents, like the NRI Indians, they're very different than you guys. You may not believe me, but you guys are far more forward-thinking than they are. Here's the problem with the Indians that left India. They left India in whatever year they left, and that's what year India is stuck in. If they left in 1970... if they left in 1970, India is still 1970 to them. They can't imagine all this shit is happening. No, no, what? That would never happen in India. Yeah? Come, motherfucker. You're gonna see. You're gonna see. They hang on to shit that doesn't even exist in India anymore. They try to be overly Indian. And their whole reason for leaving was bullshit, because they'll do this, no, I want to leave and give my children a better life, give them opportunities, expose them to different things, let them experience a new world. And then what do? They have the kids born and raised in America, and then around 18, they go, son, we know you're dating, but maybe you should consider an Indian girl. And you're like, but we're in America now. I know, but you should think about an Indian girl. I go, no, I mean, you know, if I meet one, yeah, but it's not gonna be my focus because there's so many other women around here, I might as well try something else. I mean, if I'm gonna get with an Indian girl, what was the fucking point of leaving in the first place? Yeah, at least over there, we got way more choice. But son, this is the bullshit they pull on them. Son, what will happen to our culture if we don't stay together? What will happen to our culture? Let me tell you what will happen to our culture. Fucking nothing! You know why? Because there's 1.3 billion motherfuckers right here! If every Indian outside of India never married another Indian again, we would still have 1.3 billion right here! You don't need us helping you. Even you guys are like, stop fucking, please. We don't need any more. Here's what Indian parents need to understand, is that the Indians and the Chinese will forever, always, 100% of the time, be on this planet. No matter what. There's too many of us to just go missing. If there was a nuclear war tomorrow, you know what would be left? Rats, roaches, Indians, and Chinese. That's all that would be left. And since everything's already made on this great continent of Asia, we're gonna be fine. Here's what Indian parents need to understand. If an Indian guy has a kid with a white girl, they have a beige baby. That's a win for us. I have two kids with Latin women, my kids are khaki. If an Indian guy has a kid with a black woman, that's a brown baby with the possibility of a larger penis. That's another fucking win for us. And if an Indian guy and a Chinese girl have a baby, that's a super baby, and that's a win-win, and you can name the kid Win-Win. You know who I feel bad for in this world? I feel bad for white people. I do. I feel bad for white people. I know there's some in here, but I can't see you. You're back there. I see you glowing in the dark. I do feel bad for white people because you're dwindling at an alarming rate. Like, there's not, you realize, like, there's, in about 150 years, there's not gonna be any more purebred white people. They've just been infiltrated at all costs. That's why I feel like I live in America, and in America, you see on the news, you see white people have these rallies, and people get really mad at them, and I kind of sympathize with them. You see them on the news like, the white people need to be together with the white people. They always add an H in front of it for some reason. The white people. And I'll tell you what. But they're like, white people need to be together with white people. And I'm like, yeah, they do. I'm like, what? I'm like, I'm with you. We don't want you with us. I know I'm not with you, but I feel your pain. What the hell's wrong with you, boy? I'm just saying, well, there's a lot of us and there's very few of you. I just want to see the white people get preserved. Because if white people go missing, who the fuck are we going to blame? I'm not ready for that kind of accountability. Look at Scratch, his kids are half Indian. Yes! He likes the brown. And I don't mean... But Indian parents, they're... I know there's a lot of Indian parents here too, but you need to know, Indian parents, that you're very good parents, but you're also really shit parents at the exact same time. Here's why they're good. They're good because they love you so much. They're shit because they love you so much. Because here's the problem with Indian parents. They love their kids to the point where they don't let their kids think at all. Like we don't want their brain to burn out. Just let us do all the thinking for you. We will make all the decisions. And it all stems from, we're missing a generation. You realize that? There is a generation missing from somewhere because our parents lived for their parents and our parents are trying to make us live for them. And then I guess we'll pass it down and make our kids live for us. And who the fuck is living for themselves anymore? But that's what they do. They overpower you with the, you know, son, just do what I tell you to do, okay? Trust me on this. Don't do that. Go here. Don't go there. Talk to these people. Don't talk to those people. And then I'm not the kind of guy that could ever just take information like that. I always question everything. So I'm like, if you want to see an Indian parent fall apart, question them. Holy shit, they have no clue what to do. My dad's like, son, I don't want you going to that club tonight. I go, why not? What do you mean, why not? I mean, why not? Why? I need to know why I should not go to this club. Son, because it's a fact. What? What do you mean? What does that even mean? Son, it means it's a fact. You haven't given me one fact. Son, it's a fact. Something, when something is a fact, it's a fact. You cannot change a fact because a fact is a fact. I'm like, is that a fact? So we're back in the motherland. How you doing, buddy? Okay? He must be good. He gave me like the sharp one. That's how you know you're really fucking good. Just it wasn't even multiple, just one. What's your name?
Prayag.
What?
Prayag.
Prayag. That sounds like before ugly. That's. I am Prayag right now. 10 more years, full ug. Full. How you doing, buddy? Good. You chose to look like a sperm tonight. I see that was your that was a choice you made. How did you get here? That's why traffic doesn't bother him. I was around a million others. That's an awful outfit. Priyag, actually Ugg. So my doctor says to me, hey, I just called downstairs to the clinic in the lobby and I got you an endoscopy appointment. I go, what? He goes, when was the last time you had an endoscopy? I said, never. Let me tell you something, doc. I've never shoved anything in my ass. He said, what the fuck are you talking about? I said, doc, I'm not an idiot, all right? I know what an endoscopy is. It's in your end. Os. Copy. I said, no, you fucking idiot. It's in your mouth. I said, hey, yo. It may be in your mouth, doc, but it ain't in my mouth, bro. I mean, what you do outside of here is none of my business, man. That's why I like my doctor, because he swears at me when he talks to me. I trust him for that reason alone. I don't trust people that don't swear. People that don't swear, you're hiding something. There's something wrong with you. You probably touch kids. I'm telling you, there's something wrong. People that don't swear, there's something wrong. They're hiding something. And people that don't swear act like they're better than you, because they go out of their way to let you know they don't swear. I don't know, I just find better ways of communicating than using foul and obscene language. You keep an eye on those people. They're hiding something. There's something really dark going on in their head. They got some dark, dark secrets, and they don't want you to know about it. You see them, the people that are too nice. They'll be too friendly, too polite, you know? They got dark stuff going on in their head. They're like, well, the wife and I had a lovely dinner with you all tonight. We hope you all have a wonderful night of digestion. We're going to reconvene to the bedroom, and at which point in the morning we'll connect again and enjoy a delicious breakfast together, and at which point we shall discuss the night's events. With that, I wish you all good night and pleasant dreams. And they go to the bedroom, and he closes the door, and he's like, all right, honey, shit on my chest. Because they got dark, dark things going on in there. Here's the good news. I swear I'll never shit on your chest. I like how uncomfortable that made all of you. Okay. I'm just trying to do the math on the shitting on the chest. It's... what is the purpose of this? My doctor says, listen, I called downstairs to the clinic in the lobby and I got you an endoscopy appointment. I go, when? He goes, right now. I go, so what do I got to do? He said, you got to go downstairs to the lobby and go to the clinic. And I go, and when is this going to happen? He said, right now. I said, okay, so where is this going to happen? He said, at the clinic in the lobby. I go, no, no, on me. He goes, oh, in your mouth. I go, so what's going to happen in my mouth? He said, they're going to give you an endoscopy. I go, and it just takes place in my mouth. He goes, yeah. I go, they're not going to touch my asshole, are they? He said, do you want them to touch your asshole? No, they're not going to touch your asshole. I said, okay, doc, I just want to confirm that this procedure is strictly in my mouth. He goes, that is correct. I said, okay, I'm going to go, but I swear to God, doc, if they try and touch my asshole, I'm coming back up here and I'm fucking you up. He goes, go, you idiot. So I go. Now, here's the problem. My doctor knows me. He knows what kind of person I am. He knows I've been a comedian for 30 years. He knows how my brain works. He knows how I have no filter. See, comedians look at the audience. We look at you guys and go, those are civilians. You guys are civilians. You know how to do this. Sit around each other and be normal. Just sit around and go. I don't have that fucking filter. I have to, as soon as I walk up, but these people in the clinic don't know me like that, so I can't go in and be me, so I have to do my impression of how I think you would handle this situation. So I walk up to the clinic and I'm like, hi! I'm here for my endoscopy appointment. It's in the mouth. She goes, yes, sir, we know where it is. Please come around. Okay! So I walk around and she hands me a hospital gown and says, okay, sir, just go down the hall, take off your clothes, put this on, and we'll get started. I said, I think there's a misunderstanding here. My doctor upstairs, he told me that this procedure just takes place in my mouth. She goes, that's correct. I go, oh, well then hang on to the gown. Let's just go get started. She goes, no, sir, you can't have your clothes on when we do this procedure. I said, that doesn't make any sense. Because if it's just my mouth you need access to, I'm not fighting you on this. I'm not even blocking my mouth. I'm here to help. Pick a chin. Which one do you like? I'll hold it down for you. She's like, sir, it's policy that you cannot have your street clothes on when we do this procedure. I said, you know, it's funny you should say that because I too have a policy. And my policy is that I like as many layers as possible protecting my asshole at all times. She said, sir, would you just go put the fucking gown on? I said, whoa. You swore. All right. So I go down to the change room and I'm standing there and I'm buck ass naked, right? And I start getting really paranoid about my ass. And then I get a brilliant idea. I take the hospital gown and I put it on backwards. Smart, right? All right, to protect it. But then I look down, my dick is just swinging, just like. Look, it's my story. I'll make my penis as big as I want it to be, all right? It's India. You're all like, come on, bro. That's. It's not even believable, okay? Not even on a humid day. It's true. It was cold in there, too, you know? Just. You know what I mean? Just looking like. Oh, it was embarrassingly small. Just looked like three coins in a mushroom cap. It was just terrible. It was. Oh, the worst. Oh, man. You know what I mean? You know what I mean, right, Pratik? You know what I mean? Like, it's. You know what I mean? You just had it shrivel. You ever had it shrivel up so much that you bend forward and it inverts? You're like, hey, where did my dick go? You're like, dick? No dick. Dick? No dick. My black security guys never get that joke. I don't get it. If I bend forward, the motherfucker hits the floor. So I'm like, well, this is embarrassing. So I put the gown on the right way, and I walk back in the room. And she goes, all right, Mr. Peters, just hop up here, and we'll get started. So I hop up on the table, but I put my ass right against the wall. Because like I said, I train jiu-jitsu. If you want to come at me when I'm on my back, it's your funeral, not mine. And she goes, all right, sir, just so you know, during this procedure, we're going to be putting you under using propofol. I said, wait a minute, propofol? Isn't that the shit that killed Michael Jackson? She goes, yes, it is. I go, what do you mean? Yes, it is. Why are you so happy about this? They killed the biggest pop star of my lifetime, and you think it's just okay for me to take? She said, sir, Michael Jackson was having it improperly administered. I said, Michael Jackson was having many things improperly administered. But wasn't this doctor's name Dr. Conrad Murray? Yes. Wasn't he a doctor? Yes. Well, what's your title? I'm an anesthesiologist. I said, look, I don't care what your zodiac sign is, all right? I didn't even know what month that is. She said, sir, my job is to make sure you go to sleep and wake up. I said, I said, that is a fine answer, and I will accept that. She goes, great, please lay on your side. I said, nah. Why I gotta lay on my side? I lay on my side, you knock me out, you lift up the dress, you flip up a butt cheek, you start stuffing me like a turkey. I'm not falling for this trick, lady. She said, sir, you need to lay on your sides. If we give you the propofol, you're going to pass out and you're going to fall over. And when you fall over, you could hurt yourself. So to avoid any injury, you need to already start on your side. I said, that is a fair answer. She goes, great. So I lay on my side, but I tuck my ass in real tight on the wall. And she goes, why don't you count down from five with us? And I go, all right. Five, four, three. Out cold. I don't know if any of you have been put under at the doctor, but. Sir, have you been put under at the doctor? You're an older gentleman. I mean, not older, but, you know, you're not these fucking kids, you know what I mean? What's your name?
Sandeep.
Sandeep. And how old are you, Sandeep?
48.
48. We're the same age. Same shit. And have you been put under at the doctor?
I got an endoscopy.
You had an endoscopy. Endoscopy. He had the endoscopy. And I had the endoscopy, so I think. And do you know if they gave you propofol when they put you out?
No.
No. They gave you the cheap shit? Did they knock you out when they did it?
No.
No? All right, Sandeep, open wide. Ah! Really? You were awake?
Yeah.
Why didn't you spend the extra $10 and get the fucking man? Is it even possible to do it when somebody's awake? Oh, my God. It's ironic because all the doctors in America are Indian. And then in India, they're like, fuck it, we don't need all these fancy tricks. Open wide, Sandeep. Were you 1970 or 71?
71.
71. So you're a year younger than me. But you know what's, I'm not, you know what I'm not looking forward to next year? I'll be 50. And because you know what happens at 50, they got to go with the old, you know? You know what I'm talking about? I'm running out of noises, Sandeep, all right? Sir, how old are you? Huh? 60. Did you have the old? You know, you haven't done it yet? The fuck are you waiting for? You're 60. You gotta get your shit checked. Here's the thing. When I turned 40, it's when you were supposed to do it back then. And then for some reason, as I turned 40, they were like, no, it's 50 now. And I go, yes. And I was like, I got 10 years before they're gonna shove a hand up my ass. And I figured in that 10 years, they would come up with some sort of technology, because in those 10 years, they got a fucking rover to Mars, India's got one circling Mars, the Chinese have got shit on the moon, and no, 10 years later, still,